Why?
I think you've seen that movie called By Seven and Out of Town, because well, it was wasn't it the circuit?
Yes.
The circuit, and
yes.
There were gas planes coming up, and Tom was with his hands behind his back, and I was. And they came up, and suddenly I saw them, and they went, coming up again, and this was wrong. Something had gone wrong with the gas. So I shouted, Tom, jump! You know what? Tom, jump! He just jumped in the air. I looked like the thing was all framed, and we had to get the fire people out to come in.
Don't pretend.
So that was mine.
How long were you in the makeup department for?
How long were you in the makeup department? For about 4 hours.
4 hours?
Yes. I wouldn't have to be 4 hours in the makeup department now, but I'd be 10 minutes.
Philip, you've done a fair number of Doctor Who's. Would you say Brain of Obvious was your favourite?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm talking to us straight with.
Yeah, that's fine. Can we have a question from the floor, please? Anyone? Yes, thank you.
Why is Brain of Obvious your favourite?
Because it's the most developed character, the most varied character within it. They're not, you know, apart from telling the story, the intricacies of it are very attractive, and I believed in the character within the confines of that story very much. But the variation on the stories and the variation of the other characters, especially, as I say to Cynthia, the introduction of the girls were very glamorous, moved very well indeed, looked lovely, and led by a very imperious Cynthia Grendel. And it was, in general terms, it has stood up to time very, very well indeed. And on that reason alone, I would say it's my favourite of the ones I did. Because it all works, and you're not embarrassed by any particular moment at all. So it's a straight through story. With a flow to it, a belief in the characters, a dramatic content, which is certainly the best I was involved in any of the other, better than any of the other stories I did for Doctor Who. And I think it stands out, as far as I'm concerned, easily from the rest. And I think it stands out today as well. So.
It's certainly cited as a very violent story. What are your feelings on that?
I didn't notice the violence until someone told me that lady complained.
Mary Whitehouse.
Mary Whitehouse, yes. She said something about me, she complained about me picking up the brain or something. Yeah, there's a brain fell and I picked up a brain and talked to it. You know, I said something like, oh, poor Morbius or something. Something like that. And she didn't like that. I was told she didn't like it. But I forget about the other violence.
It's when you shot Kondo and the blood splattered
around. Ah, that's me, you see, I didn't see this violence. I thought that's what happened, the blood comes out. When you shoot somebody, you know what I mean?
True.
Yeah, perhaps that was, they didn't like the character doing that. So. And perhaps the other one was sort of lovable. And I was shooting some lovable creature, is that right?
Yes.
Is that what I was doing?
Yes.
Yes, that's what I was doing.
We've got another question, please. Robert.
How would you compare the two doctors that you worked with, Patrick
Tennant
and Tom Baker?
How many doctors have I worked with?
And Peter Cushing.
Yes.
Sorry?
And Peter Cushing.
Peter Cushing. Well, they mean essentially, all you always say, they're essentially terribly different from one from the other. And
Tom won the best doctor.
Oh, I didn't know.
Yes, he did. Tom won it. Out of all the doctors,
you won it in a sort of prize giving.
That's right. Prize giving.
I didn't know what
that. And it's Tom Baker!
Did he win it?
He's won it a few times after him. They thought he was best.
Oh, right.
I think he was very dominant, you see, and seemed to be with it. Perhaps he was longer than anybody else. And as if, really, he could have made a career out of being Dr. Who. He had a drive, mental drive for it. and I think it could have happened if they had wanted it to happen, and he would have done it. Yeah, and I think that's very important. Totally convincing, he comes on, and he is that man, he is the Doctor. And there's no doubt in his mind here, in Tom's mind, if he is or not. It's total confidence. That's very effective in the audience of watching the film.
Another question, please, sir.
Yes, oh, it's you again.
What's in that work with Tom Baker?
Well, it's us. We're all actors working together. And we're telling the story, so we all are basically also into our characters. So we don't sort of say, oh, I'm working with Tom Baker, or I'm working with Jim Baker. We're working with the characters of the play that we're doing, or the television that we're doing. So we're concentrating on ourselves and the characters we are performing. You see what I mean? So I don't look at, I didn't look at Tom as Tom Baker. I looked at him as Doctor who, to my mind, was usurping coming to this planet, which I didn't like. And I had to show that. I disliked him. I hated him. I think he was going to pinch my, you know, my planet. That's what the story is about.
Philip, you've just done a big finish for Return of the Crotons. What can you tell us about that?
The Crotons in that, yes, the Crotons actually arrive after I've disappeared. I'm sorry to say that now, but you asked me.
Oh, I see. Right.
You see, the story comes along, and it's quite a story to do with me in this initial thing. And then suddenly I looked down and I saw full stop. He's dead. Something like that. And then these people called the Crotons arrive, you see. And I'm no longer involved.
Oh, that's a shame.
I'm sorry, don't buy it. No, it's nothing.
We didn't meet, you see.
You did just one seat together. We're solid bags for the Doctor's head.
I take his word.
Yeah, thank you.
I remember now. I come and ask for his head, right?
You're going to burn up in the set.
I thought that was more bloody than should
be.
Yeah, that's how I put it.
Another question, please. There we go, that gentleman there, and then you.
Philip, when you read the script for the character of the warlord in Borgia, did you read him as you played him as evil as he was? Or
did I read the what?
Did you read him as you played him as evil as he was? Or?
No, I just thought, in the warlord particularly, yeah. I thought the dialogue was excellent. I mean, very, very well written and clear. And when I saw it recently, doing this DVD for it, I was very impressed with that, the skill of the writer. I could hear the words coming out, I thought, oh, that's good. Somehow we take it for granted that because it's years later, that it must be of a lower level than, say, today. And some of them are not. They were very erudite.
Some are better, yes.
And as I was watching it, I thought, no, I believe this. You know, that's the yardstick you need. So that's, you don't think in terms of what they're doing. You don't think in terms of your villain anyway, because you're playing it for you, and what you've done may be villains. But as you, when you play it, you don't. None of the Hitlers and the Stalins of this world were doing things for themselves and for their countries and that sort of thing. They happened to be villains, but
they didn't think themselves as villains,
you know. So, now you don't do that when you do, and I've done a fair share of villains, but you just play them as before we got to come out. That's all. Is it a good part? If it's a good part, you do it.
That gentleman there.
Philip, would you like to play the role of the Doctor? And if so, where would you like to play the role?
So if, would I like to play the Doctor?
Yeah.
And if so, what?
Sorry?
Sorry,
sir. What would you like to do with the role if you had played the Doctor? If you got the part of the Doctor, what would you do?
Yes, I would like to play the Doctor. What I do with him, I play myself extended. meaning you've got to adapt yourself, and of course you've got the writer to harmonize with. So he is going to write, really. He takes you, your character in, and he will then write according to you what he sees in you that he likes. The dialogue will come accordingly. But he's not writing fiction for anybody. Now, they write for the boy who's doing it now, the one who did it before. They see his characteristics, and they give him the chance to come through. So they look at you, and they say, well, what are his strengths, or what will the audience like about it? And then write for you accordingly. But the thing with the Doctor, of course, is the attractive thing, is that you do make it your own. Therefore, it's up to you in that way. Not sit down and think, how do I make this my own? But again, make it truthful. And hope you're interesting enough to the audience. But it would be a lovely part to do, yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Philip Marder, Sergio Grant.